So we're at a cyclocross race. These winter bike races tend to be a lot of fun. The bikers fall down, they get very muddy. It's a pretty intense sport. It should make for a pretty fun experience. Now we just need to find ourselves a nice corner of the track to set up and start shooting. Before we start shooting, I'm having a quick look around to find a few good positions to shoot from. I've photographed cyclocross before, and I've noticed that it tends to work best when I shoot into a tight corner of the race course or position myself near the bottom of a steep hill. These are the places where the racers may be losing traction and are probably exerting themselves even harder as they battle gravity and slick conditions, in addition, of course, to their competitors. All of this creates a higher likelihood that something interesting might happen in front of my lens. To start out with, we're going to work on taking a nice tight action picture. So what I want to do is get my autofocus settings set up so that I've got the best chance of success. While I'm at it, I'm going to go ahead and set my ISO to 1600. There's not a ton of light out here. And I'm going to set my white balance to cloudy. From my position right here, the bikers are approaching me very quickly, and their distance to my camera is constantly changing as they come into this corner. My only chance of getting a well-focused shot here is going to be by using my continuous autofocus mode. This would be referred to as AI servo mode if you're a Canon photographer, or AFC mode if you're a Nikon or Olympus or Panasonic photographer, Sony as well. In this mode, my camera is constantly adjusting focus on my subject as it gets nearer and nearer to my camera. With regard to my autofocus points, I find it difficult to work with one single point in this situation, so I'm going to have better luck by selecting a group of points together. In comparison to the single autofocus points, grouped autofocus points are usually much faster to adjust in the viewfinder if they need to be repositioned at the last second. As groups of racers come by, I'm trying to get the lens focused on whoever is out in front, using the others to give me some background interest in my shot. I don't know where my lead racer is going to be in the composition, so this wider spread of grouped autofocus points will up my chances of keeping my lens focused on the leader. Focusing the lens on the action is going to be the trickiest part of this situation, but if I don't choose a fast enough shutter speed, then my photos are going to look unsharp for a completely different reason. As I've mentioned already, to keep our own hand movement from blurring our photos when we're photographing with the camera in hand, of course, we need to keep the shutter speed higher than the number associated with the length of our lens. In this case, I'm shooting with a 70 to 200 millimeter lens at 200 millimeters, which would indicate that I need to stay up around a 250th of a second or faster. But as you can see here, shooting with a 250th results in blurry race photos, not because of my own hand movement, but because the racers are moving much too fast to be frozen with this medium shutter speed. This is a very easy change to make, and I'll see my results improve greatly when I bump my shutter speed up to about a 1600th of a second. Today I'll be photographing in shutter priority mode, which allows me to take direct control over the camera's shutter speed. The other settings are going to be put together automatically for me. And this is great because I can concentrate all of my attention on getting my subject in focus and capturing a nice moment and composition. If you're shooting in a similar situation on your own and you happen to notice a blinking F number as you look through your viewfinder, then remember, your camera is trying to tell you something. Push up your ISO setting and you should see that blinking disappear. It takes quite a bit of concentration to get good shots at events like these. If you're new to this type of photography, don't be surprised if you need to take hundreds of photos to come away with a handful of usable shots. The more familiar you get with a particular sport, the better and more consistent your results will become. So now that we've captured a few good action photos with a fast shutter speed, I'd like to experiment with another technique that's called panning the camera. We're actually going to slow the shutter speed down to a slower than usual speed. In this case, I'm dropping down to a 30th of a second for my first shot here. And the idea is that we're going to move the camera with our subject as the subject comes into the shot. In this case, I'll start with a 30th of a second. The goal is to create a smooth motion blurring effect in the background while maintaining some sharpness in our moving subject. To do this, we'll need to keep the subject in the middle of the viewfinder as we move the camera along with the passing subject. As we move the camera and take this relatively slow shot, the background slides by while the subject remains in the same relative position in the frame. If you're practicing this on your own, try to find a subject like cars or bicycles, which are passing with a consistent speed. As you pan your passing subjects, check your results after every shot. If there's too much blur in your photos, speed the shutter up just a bit and try again. Going from a 30th to a 40th or 50th of a second is sometimes all you need to see an improvement. If you don't see enough blur in your photos, slow your shutter speed down. I've helped a lot of beginning photographers improve their panning technique, and one thing that I've noticed over and over again is that oftentimes it's not a problem with the shutter speed which is causing trouble in these photos. If you can just concentrate hard on getting into the rhythm of the passing subject and keep the camera pointed right at them so that the subject remains right in the middle of the shot, you'll have better luck. If you find yourself getting out in front of the subject or you're falling behind, then your results aren't going to be very consistent. So just try to match the pace of that moving subject and think about shooting your photo when the subject is right in front of you and keeping the camera moving through the whole time. Staying in sync with their movement will really make a difference. Again, don't be surprised if you need to take dozens of photos to get a result that you like. For faster subjects, you may be achieving this effect with speeds of up to 125th of a second. It's all relative, of course, but as long as you're not panning fighter jets or a snail race, you should be able to get this result somewhere between a 30th and a 125th of a second. I usually experiment with panning after I've already gotten a few other photos because it does take some time to work out the best speed and get warmed up. It really is amazing all the different creative effects that we can get simply by manipulating the camera's shutter speed.
Don't forget to subscribe and we'll see you in the next video.
And we've got a lot more waiting for you where that came from, so head on over to viewfindermastery.com where we've got full-length tutorials, thoughtful feedback, and a really fun community of photographers that are waiting for you to join in. And while you're there, go ahead and download our free top 10 purchases guide if you'd like some advice on must-have gear items that won't break the bank.